Okay, the final item of business is a member's debate on motion 164 in the name of Neil Gray on Social Justice and Fairness Commission report. This debate will be concluded without any questions being put. I would ask those members who wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons now, and I call on Neil Gray to open the debate. Up to 7 minutes, please.
Thank you very much indeed, Presiding Officer, and I thank colleagues across the Chamber, particularly from opposition parties who supported my motion to allow this short debate on the report of the Social Justice and Fairness Commission to take place. For the record, I was honoured to be asked by the First Minister to lead the Commission alongside Seán Robison, creating a fairer Scotland, tackling poverty and giving people the security to live their lives well is why I am sure so many colleagues here are in politics, and for me, it's especially close to my heart. I'm not only keen, I'm fiercely adamant that impoverishment and destitution cannot and will not any longer be a part of any child or any family's experience of growing up in Scotland. And I'm so very grateful to my Commission colleagues who brought experience, expertise and exceptional talent, Julie Hepburn and her secretariat team, as well as all those across Scotland who fed into our work, from academics to expert charities, stakeholders with lived experience to trade unions and political campaigners. The list of those with input is as vast as the task in hand. But the wealth of knowledge and understanding of this greatness only adds to the creativity and ambitious programme set out in the report to ensure a fairer and more prosperous Scotland for all. We did the bulk of our work during the pandemic, so the impact it has had on all of our lives has informed so much of the report. And clearly the priority we all face right now is getting through the health impact of the pandemic. Thereafter, and hopefully before long, we'll have a decision to make as a nation about who we want to set the priorities of our economic recovery. Where do we want the decisions about how we recover to be taken? It won't be good enough just to plot a path to get back to where we were at the end of 2019. We must do better. And I've no doubt that there is a desire here in Scotland, but for us to achieve that, it will require radical change. Our report is not just about the policies that could make Scotland a fairer, independent nation. It's also about how we can make decisions better. We focus on democratic renewal and involving people more in policy making, expanding the use of citizens' assemblies, expanding the use of participatory budgeting, and utilising more community ownership and community wealth building. We're already seeing the benefits of policy co-production in the way the Social Security Scotland has been built. We get better policy making when it is not just done to people, but done by those who need and use the service the most. The second element that will help us to ensure we do policy making better is by agreeing a set of values that will be the compass guiding us. A written constitution would obviously help that, but also agreeing the principles of how we create a well-being economy. That work is already underway, with the First Minister taking an international lead as part of the Well-being Economy Alliance. And finally, we focus on the policies that can create the well-being economy, and the Commission sets out a series of ideas that we feel would help drive down poverty, provide security to our citizens and make the economy work for our people rather than the other way around. Our report is deliberately not a traditional costed election manifesto. It is creating a vision for what Scotland could look like 3 or 4 parliamentary terms after Scotland becomes independent. It is about the work that will need to be done if we want to achieve that good society, building consensus and state building. One party created the NHS, but its success is now based on cross-party consensus of it being a cherished asset. And many areas we suggest should be looked at to build a fairer Scotland require radical reform that cannot be achieved overnight. A land value tax will require time to implement and phase in. It will take time to pilot a universal basic income and then assess, just 2 seconds, whether it is the best route to drive down poverty and drive up well-being, or whether it would be a minimum income guarantee. And of course, not all of what we have suggested in the report requires the powers of independence to achieve. That's why I'm pleased to see much of our report feature in the SNP's ambitious manifesto for this May's election, such as doubling the Scottish child payment, community wealth building and a minimum income guarantee. And I happily give
way. Edwin Mountain.
Thank you, Mr Gray, for doing that. I mean, I just picked up on the land value tax, and I should declare that as a farmer, I do own 500 acres, which I farm. Now, mixed farmed incomes last year were £8,100. That's hardly enough to survive on.
Mr. Mountain, could you address the chair, please? Sorry.
Hardly enough to survive on. So how would farmers cover the land value tax that is proposed in this if they've only got an income of £8,000?
Just a
question.
Well, the creation, I thank Edward Mountain for his question. Obviously, the creation of such a land value tax would be open to consultation, and how it would be implemented would be open for discussion and consultation with key stakeholders, such as himself and fellow landowners, to ensure that it's fair and equitable. And on a minimum income guarantee, as we heard yesterday from Shona Robison, the Scottish Government is already starting work on how a minimum income guarantee could work under the current devolved settlement. It's obviously going to be a huge challenge, as we have a hybrid social security and tax system which are partially devolved, and we in Scotland still rely on decisions of the UK Government being the right ones for us. Such a guarantee is about more than social security. It's about combining wages, social security and services to ensure that we have as citizens what we need and do not fall below a certain level. It is achievable. But there are clear challenges from the fiscal framework and the interaction with detrimental decisions coming from Westminster. And the looming cut to universal credit, which will end the £20 per week uplift, for instance, will wipe away any benefit for many families of the Scottish child payment. It proves to me why we need independence, so that we can direct our resources to our agreed priorities and not be hamstrung and held back by the austerity economics and the austerity of ambition of successive UK governments. I give way to Stephen Kerr.
Thanks to Neil Gray for giving way. I mean, from our previous encounters in the other parliament, I know how passionate and admire how passionate Neil Gray is about these matters, but would he accept that his comments on the child payment, on the uplift and universal credit, that this Parliament does have the means to address that issue if the majority in this Parliament feel that it is an issue that should be addressed. We do have the means to do that, to top up reserved benefits. That is correct, isn't it, Neil Gray?
I thank Stephen Kerr for his intervention. Of course, the Scottish Government is already taking action and targeted support to address these issues. But the issue at hand and at stake here is the fact that a hybrid system of social security that we have in Scotland has been undermined by decisions that have been taken at Westminster. The £20 a week Scottish child payment that we'll be looking forward to, it could be completely undermined with the £20 a week uplift being removed by the UK Government. And I think it would be beholden on Stephen Kerr to direct his efforts to persuading his colleagues in London to ensure that does not happen later this year. An immigration system that works for Scotland and those who choose to make here their home, not unlawfully housing fellow human beings in squalor and ripping them from their community in dawn raids. A social security system that provides a real safety net, that provides security and doesn't dehumanise them in assessments and impoverish them to the point of having food banks as a de facto extension of the DWP. We can and must do better. This short debate clearly won't cover all aspects of this substantial report. There is so much in there about drug reform, land reform, housing, immigration and more besides. It not only sets out a blueprint for how we set the priorities to create a fairer Scotland, but gives policy ideas to achieve a good society,
Mr.
a compassionate
Gray,
and well-being
bring your
society.
To close, please.
Just like this evening, I hope it starts a healthy, positive debate on what we can achieve and takes us forward to that goal. If we know poverty levels are dictated by the policies of our government and the UK government, I hope we can all unite behind a central goal. We should be creating a fairer Scotland that eradicates poverty. The debate we have should be about how we get there, and I look forward to hearing the ideas coming through from all sides.
Thank you. I next call Stuart McMillan to be followed by Stephen Kerr.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I'd like to thank you for calling me a bit earlier because of the circumstances. But also I'd like to congratulate Neil Gray on securing this important debate and also welcome him to the Scottish Parliament. I also wish to put on record that I was a member of the Social Justice and Fairness Commission. I'd also like to apologise that I do have to leave before the close of the debate. It certainly was a privilege to become a member of the Commission and know that some discussions challenged the orthodoxy and also the tinkering at the edges that certainly is the easy thing to do. Now, thinking about the type of Scotland that we should all want to see should certainly bring us all together as a Parliament, but I know that it won't. The report offers a conversation starter to actually find consensus about the kind of Scotland we actually do want to build with independence and how best to get there. And the Commission certainly believed that with independence, Scotland can build on the foundations that have been laid under devolution by the Scottish Government. The report stated, and I quote, "We contend that eradicating poverty in Scotland is the single most important ambition that the government of an independent Scotland could seek to achieve." And as Professor Philip Alston, the UN Special Rapporteur on Extreme Poverty and Human Rights, said, and I quote, "Devolved administrations have tried to mitigate the worst impacts of austerity, despite experiencing significant reductions in bloc grant funding and constitutional limits on their ability to raise revenue." He also went on to continue this. He said that mitigation comes at a price and is not sustainable. I think that particular comment answers the questions from Mr Kerr to Mr Gray a few moments ago. Mitigating against UK government welfare reform and also Tory welfare policies prevents this Parliament and the Scottish Government from investing to make society better for everyone. And the SNP in government has already introduced a range of progressive policies such as the baby box, as well as a game-changing poverty reduction measure such as the Scottish Child Payment and also Best Start grants. However, there is still more to do. And as Sharon Dowie commented earlier on, and I do want to commend her on her comments about John Scott. John certainly was someone who was well thought of and well regarded across the chamber. As Sharon Dowie said earlier in her first speech, she got involved in politics to make a difference. And so did I, and so did every single member of this Parliament. However, being ambitious for Scotland and helping lift people out of poverty will not be done with the glass ceiling of devolution. It won't happen with one hand tied behind our backs. It will happen when we actually do have the full powers of independence. I do have to continue. I'm sorry, I normally would, but I do have to continue. Brexit and the pandemic have certainly had a major impact on all of our lives, and they will shape our country and our communities for decades to come. It's going to take decades to pay off the pandemic debt, but that's the same situation that the UK faced after World War II. However, this should not be a limit on the ambition for our people and also for our country. Now, my constituency has some of the most challenging statistics in Scotland. Now, these statistics are people, and I want my constituents to actually have a better future. This debate that this chamber has just heard this afternoon about a just transition actually ties in with this social justice report. If we want a socially just Scotland, if we want a fairer Scotland, if we want our communities to be more resilient, then read the report, consider the report, discuss the report, and use it to engender more debate about Scotland and the type of Scotland we actually all want to see. Presiding Officer, the status quo is finishing, and a fair, independent Scotland is the prize that's coming, and it will be won. Thank you.
Thank you. And just to remind all members who are seeking to speak that they need to press the request to speak buttons, if they could all check they've done that. I call Stephen Kerr to be followed by Rona Mackay.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I say to Stuart McMillan that I stand as someone who is very ambitious for Scotland within the United Kingdom. And I congratulate Neil Gray on securing this debate, one of the first members' business debates of this Parliament. This report, however, is unoriginal. It's uncosted, which I think slips it into the territory of snake oil sales. It's a utopian fairy tale, which has been drawn up by the SNP, frankly, to distract the people of Scotland from their failures in government. This report has been designed by the SNP to try and allow them to avoid accountability and to stoke up a grievance agenda. But this Parliament already has the powers to address the most pressing issues facing Scotland today. And it is the SNP's dismal record in government that should be subject to debate, scrutiny and accountability. Take the following quote from the executive summary of this report. Quote, "The democratic renewal that independence offers is an opportunity to reimagine our approach to local democracy. There is a strong argument for radical reform of local government, guided by the principle of empowering communities across Scotland to take the decisions that affect them," unquote. The SNP do not need independence to empower communities across Scotland. They need to give them proper funding and respect the decisions that are made by local councils. Between 2013-14 and 2018-19, the SNP government cut local government spending in Scotland by 7.5%. The SNP also take the attitude that they know better than local councillors overturning over a third of planning decisions made throughout Scotland's councils in the last Parliament. Now, if that is not a power grab, I don't know what a power grab is. Another quote from this report reads, quote, "Those struggling with addiction need to be heard and empowered to be at the centre of their own treatment and recovery," unquote. The Scottish Government already has the powers to allow those with addictions to be heard and empowered. But under the SNP's watch, Scotland has had a record number of drugs deaths for six consecutive years. The SNP like to complain that it is legislation to blame for this. But Scotland's drug deaths are 3.5 times above those seen in England and Wales, who have the same legislation. This report currently calls, correctly calls for cooperation. Perhaps in the spirit of cooperation, the Scottish Government can reach out to the UK and Welsh governments to learn what they are doing to help those who suffer from addiction. Cooperation between Scotland's two governments would also promote immigration to Scotland. With an increasingly elderly population, it is vital that Scotland is seen to be open and welcome. Sadly, the rhetoric that is associated with the nationalist movement makes Scotland feel like a hostile environment for many of our English friends. Banners such as "England, get out of Scotland." Yes, of course.
Ben McPherson.
Thank you, Mr Kerr, for taking the intervention. I would just relay to him that actually his statement is incorrect in terms of the facts, that actually net migration from the rest of the UK is positive for Scotland and has been for many years.
Stephen Kerr.
And I, of course, accept the facts. But it doesn't help when the nationalist movement create the hostile environment with banners like "England, get out of Scotland," or perhaps even senior parliamentarians at Westminster. I just finished this point. Senior parliamentarians at Westminster endorsing tweets that say to English tourists to F off and go home. And I believe the First Minister and her government should be calling out that and condemning that kind of activity.
Stuart McMillan, briefly, please.
Okay, thanks, Stephen Kerr, for the intervention. Just, Mr Kerr, as an English Scot, that I certainly agree with your comments about some of these terrible things that have been said, and I'm quite sure the English Scots are yes, would also agree. But I also have to highlight that some of these individuals that you just spoke about, sorry, that Mr Kerr just spoke about, are not members of the SNP.
Well, Stuart McMillan, I didn't actually say they were members of the SNP, but I would point out that Ian Blackford is definitely a member of the SNP, and in fact the SNP group leader at Westminster. So I'll conclude. For social justice and fairness to emerge in Scotland, we do not need a change in the Constitution. We need the Scottish Government to change how they exercise their powers. Rather than seeking grievance, they should seek to create an equality of opportunity for all Scots. Rather than have people's lives shaped by their postcode, the SNP should be seeking a levelling up agenda which leaves no one behind. The SNP should be focusing on bringing us together, because Scotland is more powerful when we work together. Doing all of this and more would be working in the national interest. But I fear that the SNP will continue to work in the nationalist interest.
I would next call Rona Mackay to be followed by Michael Mara.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm very pleased to be speaking in my first Members' Debate of this new session, and exceptionally pleased to be speaking on such an important subject. You know, I'm just sorry I hadn't heard Stephen Kerr's speech in advance, because I could have used my entire time just rebutting all the nonsense that we've just heard, frankly. So can I congratulate my new colleague, Neil Gray, for his excellent opening speech and for bringing this debate to the Chamber, and of course thank him for his exceptional work as a member of the Social Justice and Fairness Commission. Presiding Officer, in order to get somewhere on a journey, everyone needs a route map. The Commission report leads the way to how the people of Scotland can live in a fairer, more equal society, one which values well-being, eradicates poverty and ensures no one's left behind. I certainly want this for my grandchildren, and this is the map we need to get us there. It highlights so many key elements needed to improve life for everyone. We know society is unequal, it seems like it always has been, but this is our chance to change it, albeit with limited powers, until we're a normal, independent country. Yesterday afternoon, from across the chamber, we heard harrowing stories of people living in poverty and the struggles they face every day. This is Scotland 2021, and this should not be happening. We heard the Tories and we've heard Stephen Kerr, the Tories who are responsible for most of the poverty creation in Scotland, and others say that we should use the powers that we already have. But as Neil Gray said, much of it is already in our manifesto. The SNP government has introduced the baby box, the game-changing poverty reduction measures, Scottish Child Payment and Best Start grants, amongst many others. But with independence, we could do so much more. We would not have to mitigate harmful Tory welfare policies. We could reverse Tory welfare policies such as the abhorrent two-child limit, the vile rape clause, the benefit cap and the cruel five-week wait for universal credit. We could have a welcoming, inclusive immigration policy, renewed employment rights under a fair work agenda, get rid of unpaid work trials, zero-hours contracts and fire and hire legislation. Presiding Officer, warm, affordable housing is a basic human right which is sadly non-existent for too many people. This must be addressed and could be with radical new thinking about the social rented sector. A bold drug policy based on harm reduction and recovery is happening now, and I believe a conversation about decriminalisation is long overdue. Under the UK government, pensions are the lowest in Europe. With independence, we could lower the age of qualification and pay a fairer rate. It's the least the older citizens of Scotland should expect. The Commission also proposes establishing pilots of two key models of social security, universal basic income and the minimum income guarantee. These would be the springboard to beating the battle against poverty. Yes.
Stephen Kerr.
I appreciate the member giving way. This is all well and good, but when you're setting out a vision or a prospectus for a future that you believe you can only achieve, I beg your pardon, that the member believes can only achieve through an independent Scotland, you also have to tell people how this will be paid for. Now, that might not be a very popular thing to say in this debate in this chamber tonight, but you have to be able to pay for these things. So how will they be paid for, all these aggrandisements, more pensions, more benefits, more everything?
Rona Mackay.
Well, I mean, I think it's a bit of a facile comment to make. This will be this is costed. All the initiatives that we do will be costed and produced as we did in 2014 in a white paper. So we don't ask people to take a leap of faith in things that are uncosted.
Not from a sedentary position, thank you.
Yes, if I can continue. Presiding officers, much, much more in the Social Justice and Fairness Commission and far too much to highlight in 4 minutes. And I thank everyone, not just the elected politicians, but the many innovative members who worked in producing this report. This report is the start of a life-changing, nation-changing conversation, one which puts human rights at the heart of every decision. It provides a map I will be happy to follow, and I applaud its vision for a Scotland I want to live in, and one in which future generations can flourish. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call Michael Mara to be followed by Emma Roddick.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I welcome the opportunity to speak in the debate that Mr Gray has brought forward. I'm happy to discuss issues of social justice wherever and whenever we can, and we owe it to the people of Scotland to have these discussions as frequently as we can, and we also owe them honesty in the discussions that we have about them, about the difficult choices that we have to make. I think it's an interesting document, having read it. I hadn't read it prior to the debate being called, it's fair to say, but I'm interested to have read it since. I have the utmost respect, in particular, for Dr. Ailey Whiteford. I was privileged to work with her for Oxfam for a number of years, and I know her extraordinary commitment to the poorest of the world and the service that she's given to people in many countries on these issues of poverty. I was interested in a quote in it. Policies must be grounded in consensus across society and able to weather changes in government and economic downturns. And I think that talks to some of the hard work of politics, actually building consensus, trying to build the consensus of a whole population and seeking unanimity, or at the very least, the permission of people to make progress. I have to say that I see little evidence of this in terms of the division that we see on a day-to-day basis between the yin and the yang, the opposition of the yes and the ultra-nos on the other side of this conversation. And we've seen that in the most recent election campaign, a divisive campaign fought between two extremes, thriving off each other. And actually, that's not going to deliver the kind of essence of what's required here. A country that is divided 50-50 will not have a consensus to build any kind of vision for the future. And I think that is the challenge, frankly, that faces the SNP and nationalists if they believe that they can achieve an independent Scotland. And I think this issue of political leadership for me comes to the fore. For those of us who have argued our entire lives for progressive taxation, your party have not been allies, quite clearly not been allies. You fought the last two general elections specifically committed to opposing Labour's progressive taxation reforms. You have you talked about Labour's attainment of the NHS.
Excuse me, comments through the chair.
Sorry, Presiding Officer. I'll get used to it at some point. Mr. Gray talked about Labour's attainment of the NHS. That was achieved by facing down vested interests through negotiation and persuasion to make the case for it. And I want to talk about the difficulty of that in tax, and particularly this issue in terms of SNP taxation policy. Because I actually think there's a salient point in talking about how this has to be paid for, the many great aspirations in this. The history of SNP taxation policy in recent terms. The first term, the council tax freeze, entirely regressive, targeted, and actually the impact of that, cutting services for local people, often the most poorest, the disabled people who require services, and we continue to see the multi-billion pounds impact of that. Second term, the Laffer curve economics advocated by John Swinney in the run-up to the independence referendum. A completely ridiculous policy claiming that lower taxes will result in higher growth in this country. In the third term, Andrew Wilson's Growth Commission, austerity on steroids. And this election back again to council tax freezes. The issue in this is about how do we pay for the issues, the kind of policies that you're putting forward, and building some form of consensus for that, please.
Neil Gray.
Thank you, President Officer. I appreciate Michael Mara giving way, and I appreciate up until the last couple of paragraphs Michael Mara's constructive approach to this debate. I think we have common cause in a number of areas in this report, and I look forward to working with him and colleagues in taking them forward and finding consensus. In terms of taxation, will he accept that there are a number of recommendations within the report, such as the land value tax and other streamlinings and progressive elements towards a fairer taxation system, but that also requires the full powers of taxation that we do not currently hold?
Michael Mara.
Yeah, certainly. I don't actually agree that there are versions of land value tax that could not be implemented now without any further powers. And I actually think that issues, this brings me to the point of the many things that are in this report that could be delivered now. Council tax reform promised for 14 years and completely undelivered. And LVT is an opportunity. I would say there is probably a majority in this parliament for a version of that policy. Bring it forward. Land reform, local government reform, the creation of new enhanced benefits. An example of this is we were told in 2014, Deputy Presiding Officer, that it was necessary to have independence to deliver transformative childcare. 2 months later, after a no vote, that policy was put in place. This, I think, again, is a list of things that can't be done. And frankly, the main contradiction within this is obviously about the Growth Commission, the evil twin document of this, produced by Andrew Wilson and his colleagues.
I will,
Deputy Presiding Officer. And it comes to that central issue about if you're putting on one hand a report that says that we have to do less and we will have less money, austerity on steroids, and the other that we want to spend so much more, it begs the question about how any of this can be achieved. And I fear that this report will go the way of the poverty czar and many other warm word promises that won't deliver what the people of Scotland desperately need.
Thank you. And I would next call Emma Roddick to be followed by Paul Sweeney has pressed his button. Is he seeking to make a... And it will have to be a very short contribution, Mr. Sweeney, because I've had to fit you in. OK, you weren't on the list. Emma Roddick, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Before starting my speech, I would like to declare that I worked on this paper. What I really love about the paper is that it's not a complaint, it's not a whinge about lack of money or an attack on anybody else. It is a positive vision, a list of possibilities, and an exploration not only of what we could do as an independent Scotland with the full levers of power, but what we can do now. The first proposal in the housing section sees a recognition of the need to not only build more homes, but the right homes. Energy efficient, accessible and varied in the number of rooms. That comes alongside a proposal to modernise existing stock, which is welcome in terms of tackling the large emission of CO2 equivalent from buildings, but also in tackling fuel poverty, which is a concept all too familiar to residents of the Highlands and Islands. The paper also suggests an expanded social sector can raise standards in the private sector. Now, while we must support building affordable homes, particularly in rural areas, such as with the SNP government's Rural Housing Fund, we cannot make policy which relies on the goodwill of landlords. We need regulation alongside house building. Expanding the social sector may be a great way to bring demand and therefore prices down, but I do not buy that it will mean that the landlords who have neglected their properties and ignored the pleas of their tenants to fix issues will suddenly feel the need to raise their standards. Which is why the second proposal, which focuses on moving away from seeing homes as a means of asset appreciation and towards being a place to live, is so welcome. Right to Buy didn't just eat up our housing stock, it also twisted the idea of what a house should be. People purchased council houses for a few thousand, the prices rocketed, and many have since been sold to absentee landlords for 20 times the price that they were sold off at. Properties which were intended for affordable rent are now owned by landlords who charge the residents hundreds more in rent per month than their next door neighbours. That is neither just nor fair. It is why it is so welcome that this paper proposes offering first refusal on ex-right to buy properties to the local authority at market rate. We must stop seeing residential properties only as an investment opportunity, an asset that the rich can expect guaranteed returns from and the less wealthy can expect to be ripped off in. While people wait for a home for years in temporary accommodation or have to move out of their local area just for the chance to look at an affordable property, we cannot justify dozens of homes lying empty for all but 2 months in the summer. We cannot justify absentee landlords buying multiple homes in Skye and elsewhere in the Highlands and Islands at extortionate rates, sight unseen, because they know that the price will just keep going up. And we cannot justify celebrating that house prices continue to rise well out of the most optimistic aspirations of our young people. These recommendations are a great start in righting these wrongs. Presiding Officer, if this paper can set the tone for this session of Parliament, then we are in for a great one. Let's continue to dream big on how to create a Scotland with social justice and fairness at its heart.
Thank you. And I now call Paul Sweeney, who will be the last speaker in the debate. Thank you.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, for your indulgence in including me in the debate. I just wanted to offer a couple of observations based on my recent personal experience of being on Universal Credit until last month. And in particular, pay tribute to Neil's work on this. I think we've discussed this in our previous lives in the House of Commons and how important this issue is. Frankly, as far as I'm concerned, I don't really care about how we do it, but we need to get the money into people's pockets. However means we need to do to innovate in that regard, that's what this Parliament's about. So I'm really keen to work constructively. I think, as my colleague, Mr. Mara, said, we are happy to work constructively in that endeavour. A good example would be the opportunity to look at the universal credit, which is already woefully insufficient, and it actually makes the cost of being poor far harder for people. It destroys potential, means that actually people's ability to even function as citizens is denied, which is a bigger cost to the community in terms of healthcare, housing arrears, all sorts of other knock-on effects that are hugely disastrous for local communities. So by my rough calculations, if we take the number of 110,000 people on Universal Credit in Scotland at the moment, roughly, scaling it up to the £20 a week uplift, that's about £114 million it would cost to deal with that issue in Scotland, and take sovereignty of that issue, if you like. And I think that would be a useful thing to consider in this Parliament right away, because it pales into insignificance when you think of the costs, for example, the overspend on the CalMac ferries or even the Rangers malicious prosecution compensation of £100 million. So let's look at ways we can actually fix this problem now. Have a good way.
Neil Gray.
I thank Paul Sweeney for giving way and I appreciate his experience of this matter of recent years, and I welcome him to his place. Does he accept, on top of the issues around the £20 a week uplift that Stephen Kerr and I were debating about, there are structural issues with Universal Credit that the Scottish Government can't address? The five-week wait is the number one issue that the Trussell Trust say is driving food bank use, and that is an issue that has to be resolved at Westminster.
Paul Sweeney.
I thank Mr Gray for his point. I think he's absolutely correct. But that's why we need to try and build constructive dialogue. And I think that the antagonism has often been a comfort for many in terms of rhetoric. But let's actually look at what technical opportunities there are to constructively engage on this issue. I think he makes a good point about the issue of the five-week wait. It certainly wasn't a pleasant experience for me. I didn't use the advance because I had sufficient savings to deal with that myself. However, I also realised that I wasn't able to actually get knowledge of what I would be paid until a week before the payment. So you're living in limbo, not knowing what you're even going to get. You also have the situation where I didn't even realise until earlier this year I was also eligible for new style job seekers allowance.
no one's proactively advising you on what you're entitled to. I also had to go through a council tax reduction, which is a separate bureaucratic procedure, and also other ways of income maximisation. So these are things we could probably deal with better in Scotland by having a sort of apply once and get everything you're entitled to sort of approach. Let's try and figure out how we can do that practically. I think if our civil servants are capable of figuring that out. I also think it's important to note that actually dealing with the DWPA in the front line, they're hardworking and kind people who are trying to be constructive, and given the circumstances, they are Scottish civil servants. They just happen to work for a master that's not particularly constructive and helpful. But I think there's ways we can deal with that and help to advance the cause in Scotland. I'd like to see us realistically explore the way in which we can enhance universal credit in Scotland and actually deliver that output that would be highly effective for citizens in Scotland. I think there's a way of us doing it, and I'd like to work constructively with this chamber across parties to deliver it. So I just wanted to offer that insight that there's a ready, willing, capable approach in this Parliament that we can deliver something constructive for Scots. Thanks.
Thank you, Mr Sweeney. And I now call on the Minister, Ben McPherson, to wind up the debate. Up to 7 minutes, please, Minister. Thank you.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And for me, like so many others, like Neil Gray emphasised, like all most other speakers have emphasised, achieving greater social justice is one of the main drivers of my political activism and commitment. We can and must create a fairer society. And so I'd like to thank Neil Gray for bringing this debate today on the Social Justice and Fairness Commission report and the issues that it covers, and also to everyone across the chamber for their contributions. I'd like to welcome Stephen Kerr to the Scottish Parliament. I think, although he has been provocative in much of what he has said so far, I do feel that it is in good faith. However, I would encourage him to acknowledge that the election has passed. We are in a different era now. And if he is serious about being constructive, then I would urge him to consider both the nature of his arguments and also some of the background to which what he said. Obviously, I made the point about migration stats. On planning law, I think it's important to acknowledge that the reporter is, of course, independent. He also has said several times in this chamber about reaching out to the UK government. I have had several ministerial posts, and unfortunately, the engagement has never been meaningful with the UK government. So if he can improve that on the matters in this report and generally, then I would encourage him to do that. Likewise, I'd like to really warmly welcome Michael Mara and Paul Sweeney to the chamber. I think they talked extremely importantly about taxation and about the issues within the report. One of the things that's been missing in terms of trying to achieve social justice in recent years has been serious budget proposals from the Labour Party. And I hope that their coming to this chamber can change that position. I mean, Paul Sweeney's points around universal credit are thoughtful and powerful. But of course, as Stuart McMillan rightly emphasised, we cannot be a parliament of mitigation. We already spend £60 million a year on mitigating the bedroom tax. And what I've never really understood about the Labour position is why you wouldn't want to bring the powers here so we can do things differently comprehensively. And of course, that also is relevant in relation to progressive taxation, where with income tax policy, we control a number of aspects of it, but not, for example, dividend income tax. So we don't have a complete control over the areas in question. Very quickly.
Michael Mara?
It's one thing to talk about making more progressive taxations. We're not a good starting place, not for the SNP government, not to put in place further regressive taxes, as they have done through the last 14 years.
Minister?
I wouldn't accept that in the circumstances and with the powers that we have sought to both give stimulus and have a fair taxation system. And of course, when it comes to income tax, we have the fairest arrangement in the whole of the UK. I would also pay tribute to other speakers. The fairest income tax system in the whole of the UK, where those on the lowest incomes pay the least tax. I would also pay tribute to Emma Ruddick, both for her work on the Commission, but also the points she raises around housing. And I'm sure Cabinet Secretary Shona Robinson will be glad to have engagement with her on those points and others. I think what's clear overall, Presiding Officer, is the political will is there in this Parliament to create social justice. We just don't have all the powers, and that's what this report rightly highlights. Nonetheless, we do all seem to want to create a Scotland where everyone can have their best start in life and lead their best lives, even if we disagree on some of the best ways to get there. Recovery from the pandemic is, of course, our overriding focus right now. But how we recover matters. Yes, we need to use our current powers well and wisely, but we also need a clear route map that looks beyond current powers to the kind of country Scotland could and should be. And this is what the report by the Social Justice and Fairness Commission provides, a substantive analysis of what is possible under the current powers of devolution and what will be possible with the full powers of independence. Presiding Officer, time, especially now, won't allow me to cover everything I'd like to in the summing up speech. So like others, I'm going to focus my remarks on a few significant aspects of the report. And the first I would like to emphasise on is, of course, social security. The Scottish Government shares the ambition, as set out in the report, for a social security system that provides income security for people who need it. We are committed to the principles of dignity, fairness and respect, drawing on people's lived experience as we continue to build a system focused on the needs of individuals. And that's why we have established the experience panels to help us design our social security system in Scotland, and their input has been fundamental to building a better system, directly informing changes to service delivery. Throughout the pandemic, Scotland's social security system has continued to ensure people are paid the money they rely on while maintaining our focus on the safe and secure delivery of the devolved benefits. With powers over 15% of social security spending in Scotland, we are already delivering 10 benefits, 7 of which are brand new and unique in the UK. However, efforts to tackle poverty in Scotland must include efforts to change Westminster's damaging welfare policies. And COVID-19 has highlighted once again the shortcomings of the UK approach. For example, the 5-week wait that Neil Gray emphasised for first payments of universal credit, and the 2-child limit, and the benefit cap. These all needlessly and unjustly continue to push families deeper into poverty. And as Minister for Social Security, I will continue to call upon the UK Government to make changes to ensure people can rely on the safety net they have paid into, and for them, the UK Government, to match the ambitions that we have to tackle child poverty. However, those calls, while they've been made by ourselves and organisations, have currently gone unheeded. That is why what is needed is powers over social security to create a fairer system to come to Scotland. And we need all of the powers to deliver social policy as cohesively as possible. And that applies, as I've said, equally to taxation policy too, and also to employment, because employment law. Because until we secure independence, or powers over employment law, we are therefore taking action in the meantime to use the powers that we do have to prioritise fairness, taking our steps forward, for example, towards a minimum income guarantee with the establishment of a steering group informed by lived experience and expertise. I could say so much more, Presiding Officer, around community empowerment, around land reform, around immigration, around drugs laws, so much more that is included in the report, because the Social Justice and Fairness Commission report highlights a range of challenges for this Parliament as a whole and our country as a whole as we begin to recover from the pandemic and move forward together. So the question for all of us is, how do we deliver a fairer Scotland, a well-being society that values and cares for everyone who lives here? That is the overriding question for us all. How do we make life better for everyone, create greater social justice, and ensure no one is left behind? And what constitutional arrangement would enable us to deliver that vision as effectively and quickly as possible? This government firmly believes that having all the powers of independence is the best way to achieve this vision. And that is why considerations around the constitution are directly related to considerations around social justice. The report we've debated today demonstrates that relationship. And I look forward to many more debates in this parliamentary session on how together we can build a fairer Scotland. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. And that concludes the debate, and I close this meeting.